Hi, everyone. Welcome to Wandering DMs. I'm Paul.
And I'm Dan. And on this episode of Wandering DMs, we're going to be talking about how to make your D&D game scary, tips and tricks to leave your players clammy-handed at the end of the session. I'll add more today, Paul. Now, here's an idea for how to make your session scary is use the feeling right before you start a public stream, not entirely sure what you're going to be talking about, because that'll really get the blood pumping.
yeah, for sure. Small commentary, a little editorial there from Dan on my preparedness. I see. It's fine.
It's both of us. Both of us. Yeah, we're a team.
Excellent. As some of our viewers may know, I have just moved 2 days ago into a new house, so hopefully everything's up and working all right. Looks like everybody says on the chat, it looks like we're doing good. So, holy crap, it works.
Thank you very much, you guys. And of course, we were, partly because of that, and coincidentally, in both of our places, we had stuff happening last week, so we actually weren't on last Sunday, so we apologize for that. And remember that we do have Super Chat on, so if there's something that you want to get in front of us that we missed and you just really must get it, feel free to use the YouTube Super Chat feature. Don't have to, obviously. Welcome back, Paul, everybody.
Awesome. This feels very seasonal. Here we are in the beginning of October and ready for some spooky elements to our games. And I'm excited how to get scary stuff into your game. Now, are you talking, Dan, specifically about how to run a horror game or how to mix horror elements into a game that's not typically horror, or a little of both? What are we looking at?
Well, that's a good point, Paul. I will remind viewers that we had an episode in season one, pretty early actually, on horror gaming actually. And so that was a pretty good conversation. Among the things we came to is that how very difficult it would be to have a horror campaign on an ongoing basis. And I think most of us agreed that would be really tricky to do. So I'm thinking today, specifically, you're playing D&D. You're playing D&D, you're playing a fantasy role-playing game. How can you inject scary elements within the scope of a particular session? And I think a lot of us run, like in the Halloween season, run a one-off game, or, here's one game that's going to focus on the undead or something like that. So I'm thinking, how can you spice up a particular session to make it memorable for your players in a scary way?
Interesting. So I have, as some of our viewers may know, I have a project that I've been working on called Fearful Ends, which is my own custom horror game that hopefully will be coming to Kickstarter soon. Definitely the move has delayed things a little bit, so apologies for anyone who's super eager to see it, but it is ongoing. And I actually put a section at the very beginning of the book about this, about tone in general of the game. And this is a game that's specifically written for horror, specifically written to be spooky and scary. And my opening gambit in that section is to say that horror roleplay is not about jump scares. And I pose the question, have you ever played a horror roleplaying game where everyone at the table experiences real fear, like real serious heart in the throat, home alone in the dark, level scared? Honestly, me neither. So okay. I don't think that's really a thing that we get in role-playing. Yes, occasionally, sometimes a DM will do something that just hits you in just the right way. But I think that level of reaction from any kind of entertainment is much easier to attain in something that is very carefully pre-authored, like a movie or a book, right? Where you're gonna, maybe not a book, maybe a book, but certainly a movie, right? Like movies are definitely always going for that in the horror, that moment of building and building of tension, then suddenly a bang and oh my God, your reactions. I feel like that's not really role-playing's place. I feel like role-playing games, it is a real stretch to get to that. And I don't think I want to get to that either. I think I want moody stuff. I want a sense of spooky or creepy or like chills kind of feeling, but not a like an immediate, like really like, oh, I'm scared, I'm going to go hide under the table kind of reaction.
Interesting. Well, I mean, obviously I hope people don't literally run away from the game. I feel like that would probably be a failure, I guess, probably.
Have you had that moment? Can you think of a game you played in, Dan, where you had that moment of, like, real fear?
Honestly, I think that I have come pretty close. And I'll okay, this was going to be my denouement, but I guess now it's become my icebreaker. The thing that I've seen players get affected by the most is when there's no safety net in the sense of open die rolls. And again, it's funny because this went around on social media coincidentally, like in the last week, about is the DM fudging the dice or not? And is that, you know, okay, or is that or not? And I'm constantly surprised by how many people have just never tried. Just, I'm the DM, I'm rolling dice in the open, and however the dice fall, that is what happens. And I've had players, particularly new ones, when I announce, you know, you get to a point, okay, here's the specific thing. So I was running new players after a couple sessions through the original Dungeon Master's Guide monastery area, and they ran into the room that has a whole bunch of ghouls. They didn't know how ghouls worked exactly. So they ran into a bunch of ghouls, and the ghouls started paralyzing the players. And I got most of a TPK off. I killed, like, you know, so the dice killed 6 out of 8 players, and the remaining 2 run. And they run blindly down the halls to get away. It branches, and they go down a dead end, and they're stuck. And I say, okay, so the ghouls are behind you, and I'm going to roll a random die for which way they go. And if it's 1, 2, 3, they go up the dead end, and clearly they're going to massacre you. And if it's 4, 5, 6, they go the other way. Here it comes. They really felt that. I'm going to roll it in the open. I've announced what's going to happen. It's out of my hands. The fact that it's out of the DM's hands really cut them. Really, I think, emotionally cut them. And I've been told later that actually is the single most memorable moment from that series of games. So the possibility of you know, the DM letting go of the story and it being out of your hands, that really hit them emotionally.
I could see that. I could see how that would add to the drama. Right. Yeah. And if you are talking about a long running campaign and having a spooky session or a scary session, right, that if you're very emotionally invested in your character and here you are down to a, like, save or die moment. Right. Yeah, right. That could be, I could see how that could, right, that could inspire some real terror.
Now, I feel like, you know, that's not going to work as a pure surprise. So, like, a thing like in a movie of, like, jump out of the closet or through a door unexpectedly, I doubt is going to work the same way. I think for our gaming hobby, they have to see it coming. So it's got to be something that was alluded to or warned about, or they've been dwelling on the threat for a while and they see it coming. And I feel like that, you know, it's pretty much what you were talking about, Paul, about building a tone, building a sense. And they have to see it coming and be worried about it.
I've seen games where it was described, and even run some stuff myself, where this sort of feels a little bit of where you're maybe describing something and the players are anticipating something horrible, right? I'm trying to remember. I think there was a game I ran where there's a large tank of dark water and all the electricity in the house is out and it's night. And so you can't really tell what's going on, but it's a, you know, huge tank, you know, easily, you know, could fit, you know, a couple people in there, right? So big tank of water, they're sneaking up on it. They got their flashlights on, and of course that's just reflecting off the glass and not really helping. So they're sneaking up and they're trying to look at it. And I'm kind of very slowly using a lot of descriptive words to just build and build the tension. And then I go, I something like clap my hands or I hit the table. I go, and then it's like, bam, a hand, a white, pale white hand appears on the glass. Thump. And I think it's not so much the that the horror, right? Sure, that's a creepy thing, and if you were watching that in a horror movie, that'd be quite scary. But I think it's the way I vocalize and sort of like the being very quiet and drawing it out, and then suddenly hitting with a loud, you know, noise. that just the noise is startling, right? Oh no, right? But I don't think I wouldn't pull that trick out often. I would say pull that trick out almost never. Because, it can be fun in the moment, but I don't know. I think it's more interesting, like you say, to have the players have that separation and be participating in, oh, yes, this feels like this other scary stuff that I know of, right? This feels like is evocative of this movie or this genre or this feeling of stuff that I've experienced before. And that, so I'm like remembering fear rather than experiencing fear. Does that make sense?
I think so. I can see that. Yeah. Look at some of the comments. So some of our viewers are saying they've found ways to scare their players. What are you going to say, Paul?
Yeah, I was I was actually misreading one of the comments from Joshua who asked, is that terror or dread? And like, hey, let's talk about the game Dread with its Jenga tower, right? That's, I don't know, is that is that terror or dread, right? Is that, are you actually scared? You're certainly very nervous in those key moments of like pulling out the Jenga piece, right? That like, I think it's a fantastic mechanic in a game because it physicalizes that tension, right? That really, I think, draws on your nerves and makes you feel dread, which is the name of the game, right? Oh God, I might knock over the tower and then everything's lost.
I called this episode on YouTube, I gave it a subtitle of Dungeons and Dread. So I will accept inserting the Dread game into this discussion. Yes, that is acceptable.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of my thing about like, you see it coming, right? It's real. No one's going to step in and protect you from this event. Now, obviously no one's actually going to get hurt or anything like that, but it's real in the sense that there's an objective, concrete reality. There's some kind of philosophical thought experiment of like, if you run into somebody who argues that the whole world is an illusion, like hit him in the head with a brick, and they're gonna suddenly agree with you that there is an element of concrete objectivism in the universe, right? So by having this concrete thing that you can't argue away, by having this concrete thing you can't argue away, it suddenly becomes literally real. And you can see that it's an actual real threat that no one's going to, you know, talk you back into safety over.
Yeah. Let me put up here William's comment, who says, for me, it took a power outage and a thunderstorm gaming by candlelight to get that vibe. And I feel like that is a thing. Sure, lucky that you had, a thunderstorm and a power outage. But you can fake that, right? You can turn off the lights. And you can, play a little soundtrack with some spooky backgrounds, and you can evoke that vibe. And I would even argue it's interesting to evoke that intentionally partway through the game, right? That's something you and I experienced once kind of by accident at a game I was running at HelgaCon, where we took a break halfway through and we changed the lighting. Right, I can't remember what inspired us to do that, but literally, like when everyone came back to the table, it was dimmer and a little more spooky, and I think that's nice. Well, it's nice to have the juxtaposition.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm wondering, if maybe William can tell us, was the power outage before you got started the game session or midway through? And you're right. And as usual, you know, it's funny with the last couple of episodes we've done with Dungeon Design together, Paul. We were playing that game, and you were refereeing, and everybody else took a break. We got halfway through, and you said, "Let's take a break." Everybody else went. I said, "I don't have to," and it's, you know, me and Paul in the room, and somehow the idea came up for the two of us to change the lighting, and after the fact, I have no idea who brought it up first.
Yeah, I think it was just a physical problem that we were dealing with, right? Of just sort of like, oh, the light's very glaring, or I can't see my dice well, or something like that. We were just trying to correct a problem, but it happened to be a power game we were running anyway, and it happened to happen in a part of the game where the players just went through a transition, where they actually went from like a safe space to a dangerous space. Right. We took a break right at the moment, so it was really well. Like, if I could plan to do that instead of having it by accident, that would be fantastic.
Yeah. Right. Right. Exactly. So I mean, I suppose so. That's interesting. So you can use lighting cues, and I like this idea of changing it to make the players unsettled. Some people use music cues, right? And when we were talking to Satine Phoenix a little while back, they've got that built all through their Bard's product of music cues. Have you done that, Paul, for the purpose of fright type tone?
I personally have not. But anyone who role plays in the New England area and goes to conventions probably knows of Andre Krupa. Does that very much so. Basically, he typically at convention games gets a small ballroom or private room to himself, and he blacks out the windows and he sets up this whole elaborate sound system. So I've certainly seen it done. And that it, sometimes it works great, and sometimes it falls a little flat. And it, you know, it's a tough thing. I think it's a difficult thing to do, because I think already as DM, you're already juggling a million things in your head. So to have to also screw around with like lighting and sound settings.
Right.
That's difficult. I would advise, if you were going to try and push for this, I would advise just having a distinct moment in the game, like a halfway point where you can say, we're going to take a break. And then during that break, you can shift the environment.
And apparently, I like that. Apparently, that's sort of what happened with William's case. He's saying the power was out to start, but it was light outside when they started. And as the sun went down, then they pulled out the candles midway through. Which is exactly what you're talking about. So that kind of shift underneath, shifting the ground underneath you, can have a really nice effect.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think that's a lot about what being scary is about, right? It's the building of tension and then the release, right? And so it's the shift of expectations, the change of like, here's another. Sorry, I'm off on a tangent. but here's another piece of concrete advice I would say for adding a scary element to your game. Split the party. Do it. Make them, force them to split up.
Okay.
I think that can be very effective. First of all, it builds up the tension a little bit. You're a little more nervous because you're not at full strength. You have less of the group around. Also, I've seen cases where you can really play into some delightful murky mirror stuff. Right, of playing with what the players know and what the characters know. I've done this in a horror game, also by accident, where one player got split off from the party and ended up going through an area that was pretty scary and horrific by himself. And I just DM'd it with him right there, and everyone else was just sitting quietly around the table listening and enjoying this. And then would jump back and forth between, because this is usually what I do when my party splits. I don't like to, okay, I'm going to do everything with you, and then I'm going to jump back to the other group. I kind of try to find moments to quickly cut back and forth between the two groups. The other remaining group was headed in the same direction, but at a much slower pace. So I had like the lone guy experiencing horrible, horrible stuff that was building all this lovely foreshadowing for the rest of the group, so that then they got to dive in and role play the scaredness, right? Like, you know, again, they're not really scared, but they're enjoying role-playing their characters blithely walking in and being like, oh, this is fine, and then discovering horror, right? And then maybe intentionally even making their characters be a little more oblivious than they should have been, just for the joy of hitting these really terrible, terrible things in the game.
You know, it's a really interesting lesson to me, because now I've seen you, Paul, run split parties at the table, and before I saw you do it, I didn't think that was possible. I actually thought that was an enormous mistake when I would always do it, it was an enormous mistake to try to run split parties. And I guess among the mistakes I would make is to actually physically remove a player from the room and physically split them up. And to see you successfully run it, everybody's sitting at the same table, and like you're saying, not get one player's scene to a conclusion, but fairly rapidly switch back and forth at moments of tension of like, okay, now you're in a particularly bad situation, and we're going to leave you hanging over there while we come back to the other group, right? And once they get in a bad situation, flip back to the other side of the table. Works really marvelously well, and I would not have believed it until I saw Paul run it that way. So that actually is a technique that works very well.
It's a lot of fun. It definitely increases the deadliness, right? So you don't want, I think you don't want to, you know, the classic advice is don't split the party, right? And that's both aimed at players because, like, yeah, it's more dangerous. You split the party and probably gonna end up dead, right? And it's aimed at DMs because, you know, hey, it's more for you to juggle and it's more annoying and whatnot. But, like, we've already accepted that you're trying to make the game scary, which probably means you're trying to make it more dangerous, right? So why not? Like, at that point, I'm like, yes, definitely split the party. And yeah, I think that's, you know, there's a technique that I found that really works very well, which is just to find the cliffhanger, like play with part of the group, get them to the point of tension of like, oh, and this terrible thing's gonna happen. And then we're gonna jump back over here. Meanwhile, back at the inn, right?
It works so well.
It works so well.
Yeah, you know, at the moment, okay, so you're going to hear me bring this up over and over again, and our patrons know that I brought this up on our Discord server this week, is I am completely obsessed with watching reviews of the video game Pathologic now. And if you're not familiar with that, Pathologic was a Russian video game initially released in 2004, and they've had a retranslation and a re-release and a version 2 remake of it, basically, and it stands out as a video game that all the critics agree really makes you reflect on whether the point of games is to be fun, because it's a game that's amazing and immersive and totally not fun at any point. And it keeps coming up over and over again of just how brutally punishing at all points it is. And I think like only 12% of players ever get through the first day, the first in-game day, and there's like 12 in-game days to it. And which really much feels like classic D&D to me, original classic D&D of like just punishing brutality. But somehow satisfying in a way that you can't really call it fun, really, really gets my juices going. So the one thing that I wanted to point out is that the game has multiple characters that you can play through with it, and they wind up interacting through the 12 days of the plot. And so you can play through as character one, and then you'll play through as character two if you have the courage to do that. And you wind up seeing what character one was doing from a completely different perspective, and finding out that they were screwing crap up in horrible ways that you never realized when you were playing as character one. And so the getting it from like this fractured mirror of multiple perspectives, multiple contradictory perspectives about what's happening, can be really scary and really feel like, it's taking your safety away, that you kind of have this idea of what's happening that's out of your control. It's a loss of control, I guess, is what I'm saying. So once again, the shifting perspective in both, like, maybe lighting cues or maybe having the split party forcing a weird change of perspective can be scary.
Yeah, that's great. So speaking of that, I want to bring up a question that John Miller asked earlier.
Thank you. I'm glad you did.
Yeah. Let's do that.
Yeah.
So John asks us, it's got cut off here on my screen. Hang on. There it is. Do fear checks, horror checks. I got it. Do fear checks, horror checks, sanity checks, or morale checks work to create fear, perhaps from the feeling of a loss of control of a character, or do they break immersion and thus reduce fear? What are your thoughts, Dan?
That's a great question. I'm so glad you brought that up, because I wanted to dig. I don't know. So I've never used those mechanics in my games. I've never used fear checks or horror checks or sanity checks in one of my games. And I even have to confess that I'm always aggravated by how often I fail to do morale checks for like henchmen. Like I always get done with a game and then go, I should have run more morale checks there. I would never do that for D&D player characters. So obviously you played more Call of Cthulhu, Paul, that has like, you know, traditionally has a sanity check mechanism built in. So maybe you know more about that than I do.
A little bit, certainly, you know, and folks will know I've worked on this problem quite a bit in some of my games. And again, Fearful Ends, coming soon, does this. It has a mechanic called mental stress, basically, where you are, by seeing horrific things and being exposed to both real-world horrors as well as supernatural horrors, it is overloading you with mental stress to a breaking point. And is the actual mechanics of that, like the doing a fear check or doing a you know, taking mental stress damage or whatever it is in the game, is that adding fear? I would say no. That mechanic in of itself, because of its abstraction, is more likely to break immersion than to cause fear. But I think what is interesting about those mechanics is the outcomes or the ramifications of failing them, right? If those have an impact on your character that change your character to force them to act in a way that's maybe contrary to their well-being, that down the road that can play off later in the game, that can pay off to give you those fearful moments, because now you're in the point where your character is restricted in what they can do, or being forced potentially by the mechanics of the game to do something against their best interest and get them into those really terrible and scary moments. That's my argument. I think that you know, it's playing into that separation of player and character. It's allowing the player to really separate themselves and put their character in threat, and then enjoy the emotional impact of watching a character get into threat, rather than feeling like I am there and I am in danger.
Well, that's interesting. I mean, and I'd be wondering, like, maybe John will share with us if he had an opinion about that. I'm assuming probably had his own take on that. I'm wondering if that has worked for him. It has felt, I mean, I've never gone in the direction of those mechanics, because they just never felt like they were about to do that to me. But that's purely tabula rasa impression on my part.
I mean, I think, like think of like your classic like fear spell, right? Oh, I cast a fear spell on you.
Yes.
You fail the save. You run away, right? Now I'm just play acting being scared. And I feel like that's the opposite of actually being scared, right? You're not like, not actually scared, right? I'm just, you know, I'm being told by the game that my character is scared and I have to force them to run away. And I think that effect is contrary. Whereas if you have something like, say, my mental stress cards that tell you that you are having auditory hallucinations that occasionally encourage you to do physically dangerous things, right? It's very vague. It's not like told you specifically at this moment you must run away, but it's giving you that open book to say, or that permission to say, I'm going to do things for my character in the moment that feel right to me. And it's allowing the player to participate a little at the GM level of like, oh, wouldn't it be funny if my character, who's maybe the only character with a gun and only armed and the only one capable of taking care of this situation, like freaks out at this moment and, you know, starts firing blindly in the air or runs away or whatever. And
it works very well.
That player is creating fear for the other players.
Right. And I'll say it works very well. I don't play a lot of storytelling games, but I've gotten in a couple of your games that used your mental stress cards, and I was truly amazed. I was truly amazed at the level of play acting occurring in those games. And I'm so glad I sat in, because it was not something I'm frankly accustomed to in my D&D games. Allowing, you know, giving a rather broad scope for the player to choose from about how they're gonna portray this ailment in a game actually worked really, really well. Really surprised me at how well it worked.
Thanks. John mentions here, you know, he says techniques we described earlier for creating player fear seem more organic and effective. I assume you're talking about things like the lighting and sound and mood and that stuff. But Call of Cthulhu and Paul's discussion make it seem like stress/sanity loss can induce player fear. And I like that, John. I like that you stressed can, because you're right. It's no promise. It's no guarantee, right? Because those things usually are kind of vague and open-ended. It's up to what the players do with it. It's encouraging the players to add that element to the game, but it's no guarantee.
Interesting. I mean, I suppose we should talk about, like, I mean, is it even a good goal? Is it even a good goal to intentionally try to scare the players? Like, so maybe you know, maybe one technique is we're going to explore and watch characters get scared, but I suppose that's a completely separate thing from do the players get scared? Is it even a good goal to want to scare the players in the game, or should that be avoided now?
That is interesting. Certainly, I would say you probably, if it is your goal, you should be upfront about it, and you should make sure that the players are aware of that the moment they sit down at the table. Right? The last thing you want to do is scare a player without them realizing that's the kind of game we're about to play.
Okay. I think there's a counter argument. I think there's a counter argument to that. Okay. And, you know, so, you know, my partner Isabel here a while back was watching a movie, and I can't remember what it was, but she's watching a movie and they're following a character, and you get halfway through the movie and the character is just sitting in their chair and all of a sudden gets shot through the face with no warning and is dead. And she's like, I hear her yelp in the other room, like she's watching it on her own, and I hear her yelp, had no idea that that was going to happen at any point in the movie. And I asked her later, I said, do you feel like that was fair game? Like, do you feel like that was fair game to get surprised with a horrible on-screen murder when you didn't know that? And we kind of had a back and forth about that, and there's no perfect answer to it. But, like, I've certainly been shocked tonally by movies, and I don't think I would have nearly had the same effect if I'd known it was going to happen, that was on the table going in. Like, the whole theme of it had to surprise me for the full emotional effect.
I could see that level of surprise could help induce that reaction, but the big difference between sitting alone on the couch watching a movie and sitting around a table with a bunch of people playing games is if you're watching a movie and you experience that and you decide, oh no, I don't like this, I don't want it, you can turn it off and walk away with very little barrier, right? Like, you can just say, nope, not for me, I'm done, I'm out. Like, I feel like it's much harder to do that sitting around a table playing a role-playing game. There's more social pressure to remain, right? There's more, and maybe you feel a little bit more kind of, you know, a little bit more of a bait and switch there of like, oh, I thought I was sitting down to this fun adventure game, and here you've like put something horrific in front of me. And you don't know, you know, as DM, like, you don't know what you're going to put in front of someone that could be like truly triggering to them. And like, really, you know, you don't know what people's past experiences are, what they're bringing to the table. Like, you know, what if my mother was shot in the face in that way? And now I'm bringing all of that to the table, and I'm just like, no, I can't handle this. You know, what are you going to do for that player when halfway through the game, they're like, no, I can't. Are you prepared for them to get up and walk away?
It's a great, you know, it's a great dilemma. It's one of those things whereby, you know, in 40, so now we're doing this. we've had some critiques on prior episodes about whether we should even discuss these things or not. You know, it's one of those things whereby, you know, in 40 years of gaming, I personally haven't seen that issue come up. And so sometimes to me, that feels like more of a hypothetical problem than a common problem.
Even movies these days, they have a rating system, there are content warnings, like may depict graphic violence, right? Like you gotta tip people off a little bit. You can't just surprise them like that. I think that's just very cruel to do that.
I'll agree with that.
You're really playing with fire if you do that, I think.
I'll agree with that. And a problem that I've been wrestling with, you know, for years is those of us who did, you know, grow up with traditional D&D have a whole lot of built-in expectations, which are not shared with all newer players who have learned through Critical Role or something like that. And I do feel, and it's interesting because I think Matt Finch said this at one point, is that what you have to describe to people as old school in contrast to what's happening in fifth edition right now changes over time. So what your description of what old school is has to evolve with how it differs from the thing that's evolving currently. And of course, as we mentioned right before the show, Wizards of the Coast just said this past week that in a couple of years, in 2024, they're going to have a revised version of D&D. So once again, D&D continues to evolve as a market entity. Mm-hmm. And so I feel like when I mentally think about like how my elevator pitch for brand new players of what original D&D is, I think among the things I have to tell them is, okay, you see happy characters evolving to success and pretty tieflings and all that kind of thing. But you got to remember that lurking in the basement, the root of the literature that inspired D&D is H.P. Lovecraft. And ultimately, that's sort of the literary root of where this stuff comes from, and it's horrible. So when you come into an original D&D game, be ready for it to basically devolve into a horror game at any moment.
Right.
And I agree, that's something I feel like probably I need to say to people in the future.
I think you do. And you know, a little bit of this is just like, know your audience, right? Like, are you playing with a group of friends that you've been played with for years and you kind of know their tastes and you can just take some risks like that? Or are you running a convention game for total strangers and you got exactly three sentences in a convention listing magazine to explain to them what it is they're in for?
Yeah.
Right. I think you can, without tipping the hat too much about the content of the game, say there may be elements of graphic violence in this game. If you're not okay with that, let me know. And then either, you know, either as DM be prepared to edit it or be prepared to tell the player, you might want to skip this game. I'm sorry.
And I also feel that there's a responsibility, the DM, I mean, I'm sort of in the DM as auteur camp, and the DM has a lot of responsibility to improvise with awareness of what's happening at the table. So they can't completely, you know, just run over everybody and not realize that someone is suffering. So they have to have an awareness of what's going on at the table. And, you know, part of the reason why I wanted to talk about scary things today, honestly, was just yesterday, kind of as a late birthday event, Isabel and I went on our annual trip to Coney Island here in Brooklyn. And they currently have their whole Halloween, you know, October Halloween theme set up. And we are not, you know, we're not big thrill ride takers. We're both afraid of heights and things like that. And so we walk in and we are laughing at like the kiddie rides that we go, oh, you want to go on that kiddie ride? And then we watch it for a couple of minutes and then we're both like, oh, we couldn't do that. That would be way too much for us. We couldn't possibly do that. And for, it's really funny because for about 20 years, we'll go every year and I'll point at the Wonder Wheel, right? So it's a very large Ferris wheel and, you know, pretty well known in some movies and stuff like that. And it's 150 feet tall. And it's been there for 100 years, actually, as of the last couple months. Actually, they have their 100th year anniversary. And so for every year I go and go, Isabel, do you want to go up in the Wonder Wheel? And she goes, no way, no way. When I was 16, I went on a Ferris wheel and it got up about 15 feet. And I started screaming that I couldn't take it. And they stopped it and rolled it back so I could get off. There's no way.
Oh my goodness.
There's no way I'm going up in that. And so I started, so year after year, I start joking about, like, you want to go up in that? I kind of like to do it with you once. Nope,
yeah.
Nope. Okay. So yesterday, 2021, she calls my bluff. She says,
"That's great.
You keep asking me that. How much do you really want to do that?" And I go, "I really actually have wanted to do with that." And she's like, "Is it on your bucket list?" I'm like, "I don't have to. I mean, now you're making me reconsider the fact that I ever asked you." And we talk each other, even though we're both scared of heights, we talk each other into it. And, you know, people are taking kids on the thing and people are eating popcorn on the thing. And it's like completely sedate. And she and I are both holding hands on the way up, just sweating bullets. Like the both of us are just sweating bullets all the way up. And I'm like, I have to close my eyes at times and stuff like that. You know, but we did it. And so we came away with this really kind of interesting confronting your fears experience. It's so safe. You're enclosed compared to other modern rides, right? They haven't had any safety incidents in a century. We could barely breathe. And yet nonetheless, we did actually confront that, and it was kind of interesting to reflect upon. you know, the physical sensation of literally literally sweating bullets.
Would you go again at this point?
Well, that's up for debate. That's a point of debate that we'll probably find out next year, actually. Is I don't know whether I should just close the book on that or not. Yeah. But the funny thing is, the other thing that we do regularly is we go to the Cyclone, which is the very old roller coaster down there. And I've done that on occasion, like for 30 years now. And I talked her into that again. And, you know, she's like, is this a good idea? I'm like, no, it's terrible. But we did that as well yesterday, and we walked away, and she's like, you know, maybe going forward, we should consider like doing something that's not actually physically rattling our bones to pieces. And maybe we should switch the Wonder Wheel, she says, as the annual thing to do. So that's a possibility. Oh.
So I think this my takeaway from this is an actual real practical piece of advice that I would give DMs for wanting to add scary moments to their game, which is foreshadow the crap out of it, right?
Yeah.
Like the more you can build it up as a terrible thing, and especially if you can build it up as a terrible optional thing, but then make it non-optional later, right? Like if you can present to the players as like don't go down the well, right? Like, don't go down the well. It's horrible down there. Right. You're definitely going to die. These people who are much more powerful than you went down the well, and they never came back, right? Like, my uncle went down the well, and he came back with one arm, right? Like, just, you know, hammer it and hammer it and hammer it, and then put them in the point of like, okay, well, we're definitely not going down the well, right? That's horrible. And then turns out you have to go down the well.
Now, right. for that to be legitimate, like John Miller said a while back, the OSR gamer expectations is we expect to die, is you kind of you that has to be demonstrated to new original D&D players that really is actually on the table. Otherwise, as we know, the don't go down the well might just be like, well, that's clearly the adventure hook, so we've got to go down the well. So you kind of have to convince your players that death actually really is on the table for that to be a legitimate threat.
You know, I poke fun a bit at the don't go down the well, because of course that's been both of our reactions, right? Is that the moment you tell the players don't do something,
right,
they immediately want to do it. You know, on the other hand, I've certainly seen many times in 10 Dead Rats cases, and I would say like actually the content pushes in this. So if you've read the Enemy Within campaign, the second and or third book, depending on how you count them, Death on the Reich, like has the players repeatedly, as they're going up and down this river, pass a very spooky castle. There's a spooky castle on the cliff here, like classic, like monster story castle, and it looks horrible, and the village around it is, the people are emaciated and not doing well, and they're fishing people out of the river near there, and it's just awful. And it just looks absolutely awful. And the funny thing is that the first couple of times the players pass it, did we just freeze up for a second? Looks like we froze up.
Just momentarily.
Okay, great. So as they pass the castle, there's no reason for them to go in it, right? You're just foreshadowing how horrible it is.
Oh, good.
But then as they play the game, suddenly it comes out like, you might need to go to that castle. This thing you're looking for, it's in that castle, right?
That's good.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. And so then eventually they really hit that point. You'll see it in 10 Dead Rats where they talked about it a bit. They're like, I think we have to go in this spooky castle. Oh, I don't want to go in this spooky castle. Like, that's the best. If you can get like one player to absolutely not want to do a thing and the other player to really want to do it and then have to argue about like, we really have to go do this. Oh, I don't want to. I think that's good stuff.
I've seen a technique in a couple like film TV stories recently that caught my eye of, and the technique is, you know, your mentor character, you have like an NPC mentor, you know, Elminster character, like, here's the information, I'm telling you what's going on, here's what you got to do this. And then at some point, have it flip so that they're scared, right? Have it flip so the character that was previously seen as being in control suddenly isn't in control anymore. And that's, again, that's a shift in expectations that catches my eye as a viewer and makes me very unsettled of like, the whole premise for, you know, narratively how this story worked is suddenly gone, and now I don't know where the story's going to go anymore because of that.
Yeah, that's a very kind of like Jurassic Park sort of sensation, yeah. right? Of sort of like, oh, yeah. no, everything's safe. Like, it looks scary, but don't you worry. Right. We've all made it perfectly safe. And then that guy gets right. eaten by a dinosaur, and you're like, Wow, I kind of super want to run a game like that now. I really want to have a game with an NPC in it who's set up from the beginning to be like, I'm your trustworthy right. guy. Don't worry, I'm unflappable.
Right.
We'll be fine. As long as you got me on your side, we'll be fine. And then have that person freak out halfway through the game. That sounds delightful.
Well, I think that's one that works, that also works good as a long play in a campaign. Right. Mm-hmm. So if you have here's the guy who gives you the quest, takes the magic item, decurses it, whatever. Right. Yeah. And so kind of as a long game, and then 3 months later, all of a sudden they're out of control. That's really going to be bothersome. That's and it's not exactly the same as like your beloved uncle gets murdered or something like that. It's like they're out of control, and you see on their face that they're scared because they don't know what to do anymore. Let me ask this. Okay, so some of us in the chat are talking. Go ahead, Paul. I might be going off.
On I had a totally separate line to go down. If you're, I do too. Ready for it. Okay, great. we got like 10-ish minutes left. Let's
of course we do.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Here, I'm going to give you mine. Here's a moment that I created in a game totally by accident. Curious what your thoughts are, if there's any useful tidbits to pull from it or stuff you could use in your real game. I had a group playing good old classic D&D. They're in a dungeon, and they go down, they split the party route by accident, but basically they discover a one-way teleporter. And one by one, each of them is like, well, half the party went through. I guess I'm going to press the button, and then, boom, you're gone. And then the next person's like, I guess we're all in. Boom, and you're gone. Comes to the last guy, and he says, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to go this way instead. I'm going to go down this hall. And so at that moment, we've got, okay, now we've got a split party, right? You had the nice kind of tension moment of the players not only like, are we all dying? Are we all committing suicide by pressing this button? Then we disappear. Are we actually going somewhere? Turns out they were being teleported. So I say, great, person who goes the other direction. And I did what you've talked about doing, which is rather than splitting it and narrating his stuff, I said, you and I are going to have a separate session together all by ourselves.
Okay.
And then I continue to run the other group. Then he came back. So this was a long running campaign. So he came back to my place for a one-on-one D&D game where I just ran like, all right, we're going to see what happens to you, right? And he goes off and he finds these cursed pixies. They're like the pixie element monster right out of the Monster Manual, but they're horrible and evil and whatever. He gets into a fight with them. He's all alone. He's obviously in over his head. They kill him, and they end up rolling on the critical hits chart. My favorite critical hits chart, which as you know is one roll for severity and one roll for location, and the severity is severed and the location is face. So like, they sever your face? Great. Okay. Cut to the next week where the whole group is back reassembled. There's the player who is missing, or who everyone knows went on a solo adventure, and he's sitting down at the table with a new character. Right? And he's kind of sworn to secrecy about what happened.
Great. Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
So the whole party, including Mr. New Guy, go walking down the same way that the other guy went the last time, all on his own. And they go walking down the hall, and I describe how they see the old character there, which is basically the pixie wearing the severed face. And basically impersonating him and being like, I'm fine. And I'm describing it that way. You see your friend, you know he went down this way, but is there something weird about him? Is he a little shorter maybe? Like, his face looks a little droopy for some reason, is it a little baggy under the eyes? And he's acting kind of really weird. And he's like, no, come with me, everyone. Come follow me. No, I found great treasure. Come on. And that definitely evoked. And the funny thing is, I had one player at the table who's just like, you know, biting his knuckle and kind of like trying to laugh the rest of the party because he knows what's there. And he's just like, nope. And the whole party then goes down and faces these marble pixies. Fortunately, since they had the whole party, they were able to take care of it. But it was, I've been told by some of my players that was the scariest moment in the game, was as the group going down that creepy hallway with someone they thought was a friend, but they all knew couldn't be a friend, right? They all knew that can't be our friend because he's sitting over here playing a new character. Unfortunately, he was a good sport, right? He kept his mouth shut and let the whole thing
go. Yeah, you're right. That's important. Yeah. That's important for that splitting type thing. Is you need buy-in and everybody cooperating on that.
Yeah. But it was really convenient. Like, it was all originated by, you know, the combination of this interesting monster I had and the horrible roll on the critical injury roll to then have be like, well, of course they're going to impersonate him using his own, wearing his face. Because that's horrible.
Were the players previously informed that face severing was a possibility in your game, Paul?
No, they were not. They did know that there was horrible, horrible things on the on the chart for they knew mutilation was possible. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
They knew mutilation.
All right, that's fair.
Several of them were already missing limbs by this point. Like, it was definitely a thing.
Okay. But you told me the overall superset.
Frankly, I didn't know severed face was a possibility. I was surprised by that. I was like, severed face? Oh, God. What does that mean?
So, you know, so one thing I would suggest. I don't know. I mean, the separating the party was pretty cured of that, right?
Separating the party was big. I also think a big part of it was seeing a character that they're being that their characters believe should be trustworthy, but the players all know isn't.
I think that's like the different perspective. I think that's the different perspective aspect. Is you're used to seeing this character get played by player A. And then all of a sudden, it's shifted now. It's being played by a different person. You don't know what direction it could possibly go in.
Right. Yeah, I think that's key. I think that's very interesting. It's very similar in my head to that mode, that what we were just talking about before, about the NPC who starts off trustworthy and is gonna be there to look out for you and then loses their shit.
I mean, the other thing is just be open to the surprise, right? Again, be open to the, you know, you trusted the dice in that case to come up with a result. You didn't come up with it, so you were surprised and things were going in a different direction. And I think at the time, it's not exactly scary, but like kind of with my thrill ride thing, my personal tolerance for that kind of thing is very, very low, ridiculously low at that point. And then there are these times in game where I feel like I'm just describing stuff clinically. And my father's a veterinarian. I grew up around animals participating in surgeries. And so on the other hand, my, you know, threshold for bloody blood and gore stuff is like, and kind of like a weird other direction. And so occasionally at the table, I have just described clinically what's going to happen when you hit somebody with an axe or a sword. And I'm kind of doing this kind of in my mind's eye. And I look over and the whole table is like, Conan Town. It's like the whole table goes, God.
Oh,
and I'm like, oh, I didn't realize that was, sorry. I thought that was just the description is all I thought that was. I wasn't really for it. So be open to the surprise. And, you know, I think a lot like other, you know, improvisational live performers, you have to be open to slightly dancing around the line and, you know, try to be kind about it, not be an asshole about it, but you kind of have to be dancing around the line of exactly what is going to be, from your experience, going to be surprising other people.
When we're talking about elements like this and the concern about safety, I think that, like, there's some good safety tools out there, right? Use X card or something like that so that you have an out, so that if you accidentally push it too far, there's a way to, like, encourage the players to give that feedback and to roll it back if it is too much, assuming that you're, you know, willing to roll it back. And that's, you know,
I might myself be a little bit more lightweight in the actual mechanic, but I, you know, want to be open and responsive and aware of, you know, people's state. And if it's too much, then to, you know, to dial it down.
I want to share really quickly William's comment here, which I think is a nice summary of the takeaway, I think, from that the moment I was describing with the severed face guy, where he says, it's like Hitchcock, where the tension comes from the audience knowing there's a bomb under the table, but the characters don't. I think that's a really, that's an apt description of it. And now my head is spinning on new ways, like, what other ways can I do something where I can tip off the players without tipping off their characters? That's really interesting. I want to do that a little more.
And like, I think in other movies, like, that's the classic, like, don't go in there. Like, when the whole audience all yells, don't go in there.
It's that
moment of you've got to see it coming to really feel it.
Yeah. Interesting. Dan, we have
You don't want end of The Sopranos, right? The end of The Sopranos is a different thing. You need for really to feel it, you're going to see it.
I don't know that reference.
I guess I'm just, spoiler alert. Okay, if anybody doesn't want to know how The Sopranos ends, you got to stop the thing right now. And I didn't watch The Sopranos either, because frankly, it was too scary for me to watch. but the very end of The Sopranos is they're sitting in a restaurant, and then it just cuts to black.
Okay. And it's just over. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah. Interesting.
And I believe most people interpret that as he was the subject of a hit that he didn't see coming.
That's clever. It's clever.
There's debate on that, but I believe that's the common interpretation.
Interesting. Interesting. Yeah.
But then you don't feel anything, and then there's right, and then a lot of people didn't like that ending because they didn't feel anything from it.
Interesting. Interesting.
Maybe here's my last thing. Some of us were talking mechanics in the chat, and here I am injecting one last thing we don't have time to deal with.
Among
the things that Joshua said quite a while ago was level drain, right? And I actually am kind of fond of the classic D&D mechanics that many people have taken out of the game of undead level draining is really terrifying. Ghoul paralysis is really terrifying. Spiders and snakes with save or die poison that your, whatever level character gets bit once, rolls saving throw, fails it, and you're dead, are really terrifying. But the players need to know about it in advance. So I think I try now to be careful about even if they run into those types of monsters for the first time, I immediately give them an information drop about you have heard that... barrel whites will drain levels out of a person or ghouls. They'll hit you once and you'll be paralyzed and be unable to defend yourself and surely die. Or I'll describe clearly lethal poison dripping out of the fangs of a giant snake. And you know that a single bite will cause a lethal end to you. And so as the players, encounter that, I want to signal that advance, and then they can make a choice about whether they want to run away or actually confront this, and they feel it coming. They don't just get, oh, surprise, that's what this monster does, and you're dead. But I personally try to be careful about that. So I might argue that telling the players mechanics in advance, here's the die I'm going to roll if you get bit in advance, lets that settle on their psyche a little bit more and lets them feel it coming up. So I actually am in favor of those things, but I got to tell it to them in advance.
Yeah, I definitely like that. I like that a lot. It's that notion, right? Of it feels the same thing, right? Of sort of, informing the players or letting the players know more than their characters, right?
Yeah.
Of sort of, I could imagine doing it just if you're don't want to just go step right out of the game and say, this has save or die mechanics. What about injecting some red shirts into your game? Have a couple NPCs that you can just be like, oh, there's save or die poison here, and just immediately hit a henchman with it. Just, henchman's dead. I attack the henchman, fails to save, he's dead. End of story.
I mean, I don't have to work at that because that's pretty much what happens. there's a really high henchman body count in my games. So, yes, I agree, Paul. That was my clever plan all along.
It's just a thought of a way you could give the players the information without just giving the players the information, right? Right.
Yeah, okay. I mean, even that they've invested, they've invested, getting the henchmen for me. So, I have not minded, I have not minded stepping in and saying, you remember, you have heard about blah, you've heard the myth of the legend of the thing. I have not personally been bothered by stepping in and giving some in-game information that way.
Yeah, I think that's totally reasonable. All right, we're definitely out of time. So, viewers, if you have other interesting ways to inject some spooky, scary, horror moments into your regular non-horror game, which seems to be basically the thrust of what we're getting at here, please leave us comments here in the video. We'd love to hear other ways that you can inject some scary stuff into your Halloween games coming soon.
Definitely. And I think in summary, Paul, I think we agree in letting them see it coming in advance. And I'm personally in favor of letting objective dice or maybe dread mechanic, like some objective thing in the world that the DM doesn't have their thumb on, be the determination. And that can be pretty scary.
Yeah, sure. That's the control. Yeah.
Right. So remember, maybe if you're new to the show, that you can like, follow, and subscribe to us, the Wandering DMs, and we are on Twitter and Twitch and Facebook and also GitHub, and we have the handle Wandering DMs on all of those sites. So look for us there for updates about future shows.
If you prefer to listen to our shows in audio-only podcast format, you can do so. Those files are available on our website at wanderingdms.com. You can also find us on various carriers like Google Podcasts, iTunes, Spotify. If you are listening to us through one of those apps, please take a moment to rate and review us there. That helps other users of that app find our show, and we really appreciate it.
We very much appreciate it. And of course, thanks to our patrons who support this show. And if you'd like to join them, please visit patreon.com/wanderingdms. And the different tiers have discounts on merch, access to our private Discord server, monthly behind-the-scenes videos and polls and surveys, and also after-party chat that we have every Sunday right after the show. We'll be there in about 10 minutes. Paul will be back on Monday. We're looking for a schedule to find our next Book of War Wargaming show Saturdays. But don't forget that we are live every Sunday at 1 p.m. Eastern time. So we hope that you'll join us again next week for another thought-provoking discussion.
We'll see you then.